I'm delighted that we're here to celebrate the new authoritative translation from Penguin Classics. I wanted to thank Elda, Sam, and Andrea from Penguin Classics. One thing I've learned from working with them is that when readers like you buy the titles, it's actually very important because it allows them to make arguments back at Penguin that they should do more translations of Asian works. And this is not just the first authoritative translation of Hong Gildong, but it's actually the first Korean book within Penguin Classics. So I hope you enjoy it and you buy the book and you read it because it's only 77 pages long in the translation section. As many of you know, it's a kind of delightful, picaresque tale of Hong Gildong, who's a good bandit, a good thief, often likened to the Robin Hood of Korea. He engages in a sort of class warfare, being the son of a nobleman, but also of a concubine. But as Minsoo Kang argues in the book is not quite as political as you might think. He also says it's the greatest work of pre-modern Korean literature, one that's so influential that the name Hong Gildong is often used as something like John Doe, to name a generic person. And as Minsoo recently said on NPR, he's been to Korea where you see gravestones that just say Hong Gildong, either to indicate a generic person or to indicate a fictional character who has died, apparently. I want to say this event is co-sponsored by the Department of East Asian Languages and Cultures and the Center for Korean Research, both at Columbia University. And the format is Marie and Minjin will do short talks about their relationship with Hong Gildong. Minsoo has prepared a talk with imagery from the many adaptations, and then he and I will engage in a conversation. So I hope you can think about your questions and overcome your readerly introversion. So first we have Marie Myung-Ok Lee, who is a graduate of Brown University, and both one of the founders and former board president of the Asian American Writers Workshop. She's the author of the novel Somebody's Daughter from Beacon Press, and her next book is forthcoming from Simon & Schuster. She's been published in many places, including the New York Times, Slate, The Guardian, The Nation, The Atlantic, and Salon. Minjin Lee, you may have read her novel Free Food for Millionaires. It was a number one Book Sense pick, New York Times Editor's Choice, a Wall Street Journal Books Club selection, and of course a national bestseller. It was on a number of top 10 lists of the year, including that of the Times of London, Fresh Air on NPR, and USA Today. And she has a new book coming out soon, which you should buy, Pachinko, which is about one of the great loves of Asian people, which is, say, gambling. So we'll hear from Marie and then Minjin. Let's give them all a hand.
Thanks for that introduction, Ken. And it's so great to be here. Dudes, when we first started it, the Asian American Writers Workshop was a restaurant that we had a table at. And there's actually a couple OGs in the audience. But it's so great to be in this place that has these events. And thanks for coming. And I guess thank you, AAWW. Thank you to my co-readers, Minjin and Minsoo, whose work I both adore. And wow, until Ken even talked about the video game, I'm realizing I'm a little bit divorced from Hong Gildong culture. I'm actually also a newcomer to this story, and I think it's a generational thing because my parents immigrated to the US in 1953, right after the Korean War. And they began their American lives in Jim Crow, Alabama, and then northern Minnesota. So I think they really wanted their kids to grow up American and sort of unhindered by their Korean background. So we never ate any Korean food. My parents only spoke English in the house, even though I begged them to teach me Korean. And in fact, one of my friends with whom I'm going to be taking remedial Korean classes in the audience. I'm very excited. I also wanted to learn Taekwondo when I was younger, but my parents also thought that was too Asian-y or something. They were trying to get us to do tennis and ice skating. So it wasn't until I was an adult and making my own choices. I spent a year in Korea as a Fulbright scholar where I was researching my first novel. And it was there when I had to fill out a form for my bank account that there was a name, Hong Gildong. And so I was asking my friend who was there helping me fill out the form what this was. And so she kind of got me up to speed with the story of this Korean Robin Hood. And so I kind of would see it from time to time, but my Korean never got good enough that I could ever read a story about it. And my father passed away a little over 10 years ago. And he left behind these voluminous diaries. It was mostly written in English. And in one part, he mentioned that his nickname when he was young was Hong Gildong. So it got me kind of interested because first, I couldn't really see my father as a Korean Robin Hood. I did a piece for the Times a long time ago you may have seen called Mitt Romney and my dad's, Mitt Romney's Muffin Tops and My Asian Dad. It was about how Asian Americans, like our parents, like tend to vote really Republican, but that Mitt Romney might turn them off. And so my dad was not exactly, he's a physician. He was a staunch Republican. He was always railing against socialized medicine. So I didn't quite see where the nickname Hong Gildong might have come from. But along comes this book. It's in English, and it's such a beautifully written translation that it was so much fun for me to read. And then finally, I could see these resonances with this story about this secondary son. He's lowborn, born to a concubine, who's kind of never good enough, or he wants to succeed despite his lowborn status. And so it made me really think so much about how with my dad, even though he graduated from Seoul National University, which is the Harvard of Korea, that growing up, you know, in an all-white area in Minnesota, that you could always tell that he always felt like that he was secondary and that we were secondary, and that the only way that we could really become primary is if, well, we all went to Harvard, basically, and succeeded like on white people's terms. And unfortunately, I failed in that aspect of it. And being a doctor was also supposed to be part of this journey. But now when I'm looking back on it, you know, this story is really fun. And as Ken said, it's picaresque, but it did resonate with me in such a way because it made me realize, you know what, for my dad, you know, who was kind of really the original tiger dad, when I was born, that's when he sent away for my Harvard application, the day I was born. And when I was 10, he made all the kids take the IQ test, and mine was the lowest of the four. But I'm realizing that, you know, for my dad, that his dreams for us and for us to succeed and for him to become a doctor and succeed in America, even though in the 50s, it was so impossible for anyone to try to even think of immigrating, that in his own way, that was his own hero's journey. So this translation is so wonderful that I'm just finding it that not only for someone who's second generation or Asian American, that it's so exciting that it's going to be a Penguin classic, because it's one of these things where everybody should be familiar with Korean literature because it has a very long history. And this is probably one of the great ways to do it, because this translation is fluent, it's actually very funny, and there's this very beautiful stylized language that I'm just very much enjoying. And one little fact too that's interesting is that when Americans have reading materials, only 3% of that is ever work that's in translation. So that's one of the things that I also feel that as Americans, we need to read more about other cultures, other countries, and in other languages. So I'm really grateful to Professor Kang for just starting off the Korean literature with such a great piece of work. So I'm just gonna read a little bit from the beginning. And it's starting with the minister who is the father-to-be of Hong Gildong. On a warm spring day, the minister was suddenly overcome by fatigue and fell into a dream. He found himself in a place where verdant mountains lay in multiple folds, fresh waters flowed gently, and willow branches were arrayed like so many canopies of green. In the midst of the fairest panorama, golden songbirds calling for their mates evoked the pleasures of spring.
awed by the grandeur of the scenery, the minister strolled through the land until the path he walked on ended at a rocky cliff that soared up to pierce the sky. A waterfall that fell from the height looked like a white dragon at play, and the mountain stone wall of 10,000 Zhang was covered in many colored clouds. Filled with joy at finding himself in such a marvelous world, the minister sat on a rock to fully appreciate the beauty all around him. Suddenly, deafening explosions of thunder shook heaven and earth. The waters rose up in a tumultuous eruption, and a fierce tempest blew through the land. A blue dragon appeared, shaking its beard, glaring with its frightful eyes, and opening wide its red mouth as it rushed at the minister to hunt him down. Taking great fright, he tried to flee from the creature, but it quickly enveloped him. He woke up then and realized it had all been a dream. The minister felt a great happiness in his heart, and he immediately entered the inner chamber of his house, where his wife stood up to greet him. With a delighted expression on his face, he led her to the resting place of the room. There he took her exquisite hands and made apparent his intention to become one with her in a decorous manner. But his wife's delicate features turned serious as she spoke to him. "Your lordship is a person of high position in the world and no longer a young man of excessive vitality. So why are you acting like a licentious youth in broad daylight and in view of the maids who spy upon our chamber? For the sake of your dignity, I will not comply with your desire." She withdrew her hands, opened the chamber's door, and walked out. The minister felt embarrassed by the situation and considered explaining his behavior by telling her of the dream. But he resisted the urge as he felt it was wrong to divulge a secret. To divulge a secret vision that heaven had granted him. Unable to allay his frustration, he went to the outer chamber with an upset expression as he lamented his wife's lack of understanding. It was then that a maid named Chunsum entered the room to serve him tea. After the minister took his drink, he saw that all was quiet in the household, so he took Chunsum's hand and led her into a side chamber where he lay with her. She was a girl of 19 years at the time. Although Chunsum was only a servant girl, she had a gentle nature and her demeanor and actions were always as proper as those of a respectable maiden. She may have been low-born, but there was nothing lowly about her character. When the minister approached her so suddenly with an authoritative air and made apparent his ardent desire for her, she dared not resist his advance and allowed him the use of her body. From that day on, she never ventured outside the house and showed no interest in other men. The minister was so impressed by her loyalty that he made her a concubine. Within a month, Chunsum began to show signs of being with child, which earned her the animosity of a senior concubine whose name was Chorang. The latter was a person of wicked character who became filled with jealousy when she learned of the pregnancy. She dared not reveal her feelings in words or looks, but she resented the minister for his actions and regarded Chunsum with hatred. And so time passed through 10 lunar months until a day came when a tempest blew, fierce rain poured down, and a fragrant air filled the house. Chunsum gave birth to a precious boy whose face was the color of snow and whose presence was as grand as the autumn moon. He was born with the appearance of a great hero. The minister was delighted and gave him the name of Gildong.
It's good to be home. I don't know if you guys know this, but my friend Ed, where are you, Ed? Ed and I actually took a class here 100 years ago. Right, Ed?
That's right. I preserved wood from that time.
good evening. I want to thank Ken, and I want to thank Marie and Minsoo. And I want to thank Columbia and all sorts of people. But I really want to thank you for showing up today, because this is a really amazingly good-looking crowd, which is very important. I feel really lucky to be here because I'm with writers that I really admire. But I'm also really, I feel really lucky to be here because I never get to talk about Korean stories that affect me. And I was born in Korea, and I came here in 1976 when I was almost 8. So I actually read a lot of Korean little like stories and folktales, and they pretty much informed my character and pretty much all of my psychological problems. but we won't get to that now. This week, to publicize this event, I actually ventured on Twitter. And I don't know, like, it's 140 characters, and I write long books, so it's really kind of challenging for me. But I tweeted, Hong Gildong equals O period G period, which you know means original gangster. And for me, Hong Gildong, or as I like to call him, HG, is my OG. So, and we're going to return to this OG idea. I'm not going to give you the summary of Hong Gildong or HG because you already know most of the story, but I do want to touch upon this idea of him being the Korean Robin Hood, because he's often referred to as a Korean Robin Hood, which is, you know, in some ways easy and in some ways problematic. And the easy part that makes sense to me is that, like Robin Hood, HG is anti-clerical, and he's also anti-establishment when they are corrupt. So like Robin Hood, that's correct. And like Robin Hood, who in England's socioeconomic class status terms be considered a yeoman is neither a peasant nor a knight. So he's in this liminal state of being a commoner, but not neither extremes. And you also have the same situation with HG, because HG is, again, not a noble person, but again, he's not a peasant. And this anxiety of being neither is something that I think all of us can relate to. However, unlike Robin Hood, HG is not interested in stamping out class oppression. He seeks a restoration, actually, of what he believes is to be a merit-based kingship. Now, as you know, no matter how much unfairness he suffers, and when you know the story better, you'll realize what I'm talking about, is that when he suffers and suffers and suffers at the hands of people who are deeply unfair, like his own stepmother plots his assassination when he's 10, what he does is he does a really Korean thing. He studies. Like, he studies, and then he studies, and then he studies some more. And then through all of his studying, he develops these really super cool skills, like invisibility and flight. And, well, mind reading, sorcery. And he becomes an outlaw only temporarily, and he overcomes his obstacles through superhuman skills. And he establishes his own kingdom, so he becomes a king. It's not like he becomes a revolutionary, through intelligence and might. He does not believe in democracy. It's much more like Singapore. It's a benevolent dictatorship. So, why does this story matter? And why does this story matter to us? Why does it matter to me? Well, Minsoo, a writer and a professor of history, tells us, and I'm only going to read you three sentences because I think this book should really be supported. I hope that you pick one up, and I hope that you'll read on page 20, and I'm only going to read you three sentences. In the history of modern Korea, the people of the peninsula have experienced a series of humiliations, from colonization, forced division, and domestic oppression. As a result, the theme of being disrespected, unappreciated, and underrated by callous and unwise authority figures, blind to the emotional needs and the substantial talents of the protagonist, so well portrayed in the first part of the story of Hong Gildong, has a profound resonance in the Korean psyche. Well, yes. I imagine that all of us have felt structural inequities and faced misunderstanding as people of color, as ethnic or religious minorities, as for women, for our sexual identities, our political affiliations, our appearances, class identities, or disabilities. So is Hong Gildong our story? I don't know. I don't know, because it seems really dangerous to me to think that the Hong Gildong narrative is a how to succeed manual when the world is unfair. Because the world is unfair. No matter how hard we try, most of us will never know how to fly, turn invisible when necessary, disorient our enemies, alter time and space, except for Keanu Reeves, disorient our enemies and fight a legion of men at once, read minds and know exactly how to outwit those in power at all times. And this is important. I think working hard and being better than everyone else is a highly oppressive and problematic and absurd model for anyone who's already an outsider and is already handicapped. I still like the book. Now, for me, the Hong Gildong narrative is not a how to succeed manual. Rather, it's a rich story of the grief of being an outsider. It is a fantasy revenge narrative of someone who has been mistreated because of his birth. And HG is a penetrating psychological profile of a person who wants very much to be loved properly and without conditions. And I think that is actually our story. In my first novel, Free Food for Millionaires, I wrote about Koreans in America. And my main character, Casey Han, is a young Korean-American woman from a working class family in Elmhurst, Queens. And she graduates from Princeton, and she realizes that although she's very well educated, her options are not the same as her peers who have great privilege. And in this novel, I wrote about all the different kinds of Korean Americans who are negotiating their identities in America. And no matter their backgrounds, all of them recognize they are outsiders as well as insiders. Hong Gildong wants respectability above all things. That is his redemption. He wants to be respected. But my character, Casey, rejects that as the primary pursuit of an American immigrant. And I posit that the ability to choose or not to choose respectability is a different kind of psychological liberation. In the first page of Free for Millionaires, I'm going to read one sentence I wrote a long time ago. Casey Han felt compelled to choose respectability and success, but it was glamour and insight that she craved. Now, for me, the narrative of Hong Gildong is important because here we get to understand why a person chooses his fate. My second novel, Pachinko, which is coming out in February, is also a community novel. But this time I wrote about Koreans in Japan, who, as you may know, have suffered grievous indignities as foreign residents for over 100 years. In Japan today, Koreans are often viewed as a suspect class of people. The majority culture indulges in the stereotype that many Koreans today are criminal, filthy, manipulative, and dishonest. Now, some Japanese actually believe, not all, some, believe that Koreans have inferior blood. Structurally and institutionally, today, ethnic Koreans are still discriminated against by being unable to rent property, having jobs like nursing, policing, teaching, and they may not be hired by Japanese companies. So historically, most Korean Japanese went into small businesses, including the pachinko business, which is often viewed with contempt. Some members of the Korean Japanese community, a tiny minority, actually took Hong Gildong's path and became outlaws. And some became members of the Yakuza, the Japanese Organized Crime Association. It's interesting to note that Yakuza members themselves believe that they are ninkyo dantai, which means a chivalrous organization, and a band of brothers with a clear moral dictate. So part of what I do in fiction in these two novels is to explore why characters choose to leave the tribe. My sense is that probably all of us in this room understand what it's like to leave a tribe. We all live in New York, right? We came from somewhere. An outlaw is often a fugitive who has broken the law and no longer gets protection from society. But why does the outlaw leave society in the first place? And Hong Gildong answers the question. One becomes a bandit, the precursor to the modern-day gangster, because society's laws are intrinsically unfair to him. Now that said, I think the reason why HG is so popular is not because Koreans want to leave society and commit property crimes, but because HG leaves society and then returns to it on his own terms triumphantly. HG wants respect, he wants fairness, he feels that he is more gifted than the average person, and feels that it is inequitable to deny his specialness. Now, HG asks the questions that I think all of us ask. Who should be king? Who should be respected? And who is truly noble? Who is the OG and why? And as writers and readers, we are puzzled and disturbed by the inequities that we see and experience today. We try to make art and create our own other worlds. We're not HG, but we read and we write because we feel the same things that he does. I wanted to close by quoting a tiny bit of Ice-T's rap, OG. I know my son is here. He's mortified. And I left my beatbox at home. So I hope that you and Ice-T will forgive me for this tiny pivoting of my career. When I wrote about parties, someone always died. When I tried to write happy, yo, I knew I lied. I lived a life of crime. Why play you blind? A simple look and anyone with 2 cents would know I'm a hardcore player from the streets, rapping about hardcore topics over hardcore drum beats. A little different than the average, though. Jet you through the fast lane, or drop you on death row. Because anybody who's been there knows that life ain't so lovely. I rap for brothers just like myself. Days by the game in a quest for extreme wealth, but I kick it to you hard and real. One wrong move and you caps peeled. I ain't no superhero. I ain't no Marvel comic. But when it comes to game, I'm atomic at dropping it straight, point blank and untwisted. No imagination needed because I lived it. I'm Ice-T. OG, I'm Ice-T, the original gangster. So step to me if you think that you're ready to. Got on your bulletproof? Well, mine's going right through. This ain't no game to me. It's hollow fame to me without respect from the streets. I use my pad and pen, and my lyrics break out mad. I try to write about fun and the good times, but the pen yanks away and explodes the rhyme. Maybe it's just because of where I'm from, L.A. That was a shotgun. The modern writer Ice-T understands the impulses and motives of RHG. So what compels us to read and write? Is it a wish for respectability? Is it a wish to cover our shame? Is it a wish to kick it to you hard and real? Or is it a wish to be loved? We read and we reread the story of Hong Gildong because it answers these questions. Thank you for coming out tonight, and thank you for being so gangster.
Thank you, Marin and Minjin. Next, I'm delighted that we have a special New York visit from Minsoo Kang, who of course is the translator of this edition. He's an associate professor of European history at the University of Missouri, St. Louis. He's the author of 2 books, Sublime Dreams of Living Machines, The Automaton in the European Imagination, and a short story collection of tales and enigmas. He's the co-editor of the book Visions of the Industrial Age, 1830 to 1914, Modernity and the Anxiety of Representation in Europe. And in addition to this Penguin Classics, is working on another book about Hong Gildong, a scholarly book. Let's all give him a hand.
Thank you, Kevin. for inviting me. I'm used to teaching these very big undergrad classes, so forgive me if I project too much. You usually don't use a microphone, so. So I was just absolutely delighted to be here, and I was stunned and delighted that Marie and Min Jin was going to be sharing the stage, because two of my favorite writers, and I just could not have worked out better. So what I would like to do is, I'm glad this is not overlapped too much with Marie's wonderful reading, and it's so great to at some point be writing this on my computer and just hearing it spoken out loud. It's just so wonderful. And Minjin's wonderful take on it, interpretation of this. I'm absolutely delighted. And also I'm glad that what I prepared doesn't overlap too much, right? Because you don't want to hear the same thing twice. So I thought I'd like to do two things. One, tell you a little bit about how I came to this project. About why, as a European historian, I ended up taking on this big project that's really outside of my field, and also do a little slide presentation of to sort of illustrate the absolute importance of the figure of Hong Gildong in Korean culture since the 20th century. That's some bizarre stuff that bizarre ways in which it was reinterpreted and since the colonial era, right up to, as you mentioned, recent shows. Okay, so this all began for me when I was an undergrad, and I took a class on the Introduction to Cultural History as a history major. And one of the books that we read for that class was by the great historian Eric Hobsbawm, and it's a book called Bandits. And it's a stunner of the book. I always recommend the book when I talk about the story of Hong Gildong. My old professor, Carlo Ginzburg, always used to say that, some of the greatest history books are the ones that defamiliarize the familiar. Take something that we all think is just so completely normal, and then for historians to point out and say, actually, this is really weird. I mean, and we have to look at it, where this comes from. And the premise of Eric Hobsbawm's book is this. We come together, form societies, create governments and laws, and we all do that because we don't want to live in the Hobbesian state of nature where we're in danger all the time and fighting each other all the time. So it's a good thing that we come together and have civilization, right? And therefore, it is natural that in our literature and in our mythology, we lionize the defenders of civilization. The defenders of law, right? I mean, that's all obvious, right? But why is it that we also lionize outlaws, right? Why are we as fascinated, if not more, by somebody like Al Capone as we are by Eliot Ness? I mean, that's actually really strange if you think about it. That we sometimes even make heroes out of outlaws. And even if they're not heroes, if they are portrayed as villains, we're completely interested in them. And sometimes to the detriment of the reputation of the actual law, abiders, defenders of the law. And what this book, this wonderful book, tries to answer the question, right? How and why we do that. And the way the book is divided, he goes through several different types of outlaws as either heroes or celebrities. And among the different categories of of such figures, here's a chapter on the figure that he calls the noble robber, right? The noble robber. And to elaborate, he says that if you look at the noble robber, there's nine basic characteristics, general characteristics of which the noble robber is characterized by. First, the noble robber begins his career of outlaw not by crime, but as a victim of injustice or through being persecuted by the authorities of some acts which they, but not the custom of the people, consider criminal. Right? Second, he rights wrongs. Third, he takes from the rich and gives to the poor. Fourth, he never kills but in self-defense or just revenge. Fifth, if he survives, he returns to his people as an honorable citizen and member of the community. Indeed, he never actually leaves the community. Sixth, he is admired, helped, and supported by his people. Seventh, he dies invariably only through treason, since no decent member of the community would help the authorities against him. Eighth, he's, at least in theory, invisible and invulnerable. Ninth, he's not the enemy of the king or the emperor, who's the fount of justice, but only of the local gentry, clergy, or other oppressors. Right? Okay, so when I was reading this, obviously the most famous figure is Robin Hood, right? I mean, that's like for instance, the interesting conservative element of the ninth thing, as soon as the King Richard or whichever authority figure shows up, his adventure ends, right? And a lot of times as Minjin pointed out, they're not real revolutionaries. They're not out to change the society. And a lot of times they're saying, it's not the king, it's the local abusers. And also they look to the past. They said, what's happening now through the abuse of authority is that we are losing our traditional rights. Once upon a time, there was this intimate, benevolent relationship between the rulers and the subjects, but now that's been broken and so on and so on, right? So obviously, this is Robin Hood, but the reason why this book was so life-changing for me is that Eric Hobsbawm points out that you can find this guy everywhere in the world, of which Robin Hood is just, he finds one in East Africa, he finds one in Latin America. There's a Chinese Robin Hood. There's a Japanese one, and there's a bunch of Eastern European ones. And they more or less fit these characteristics, right? And this was very useful for me because it's not like, Korea, Hong Gildong, or any of these other figures are not local versions of Robin Hood. Like Robin Hood is the standard, and the rest are just sort of variations, right? This is a universal figure. Right? It's a kind of category of what Joseph Campbell would have called the hero with a thousand faces. Although I'm not a huge fan of Joseph Campbell's because he's very good at synthesizing, but a lot of times he ignores the unique aspects of it, right? Because I think that's as important, right? You got to look at these characters base by basis and actually do a comparison as to elements of this story where they do fit the common characteristic and the ones in which it doesn't. There's a couple of characteristics here that Hong Gildong, that doesn't fit Hong Gildong, right? So we're all thinking about that, and I'm immediately thinking, hey, I know this dude, right? This is Hong Gildong. This is one of my heroes from childhood, right? I was reading through this and so on. But here's the thing. I've never read the story of Hong Gildong. The actual text. I think the vast majority, perhaps as much as 95 to 99% of Koreans have never read the actual full text of the story of Hong Gildong, right? But just as you can imagine, though, if you go to England, what percentage of British people think do you think they actually read the medieval and Renaissance texts of the Robin Hood text, right? Now these things are, but here's the point though. Every Korean knows or thinks that they know the story, right? And they all can recite, I cannot even address my father as father. I cannot address my older brother as brother, right? What kind of life is this, right? And they know stories about his outlawry and all of that. That's all so famous, and that's all just all seeped into the culture. As is Robin Hood for not only people of Britain, but for people all over the world through many different versions of it and so on. And also, I did a lot of like Robin Hood research. That's actually really complicated too. The story that you think you know about how he's a partisan in the Norman-Saxon conflict and all that, that's actually a very late development. In the earliest medieval versions, the story took place at a very different time. There's a reference to King Edward rather than King Richard, and so it's very, very common. There's not one Robin Hood. There's dozens of different Robin Hoods that with conflicting stories about what he did and so on. In the earliest one, he doesn't even there's actually no taking from the rich and giving to the poor. He's just a badass, it's much later on when I think during the Renaissance they need to make him a more moral exemplar. There's the yeoman story. In the Renaissance, they start making him into a last nobleman, right? And which shows up in these movies, with like that Kevin Costner movie, right? He's a nobleman who's been deprived of his position and so on. So it's very complicated. Now, the thing is, though, What I did for that class was that I ended up writing my final paper for it. And there was the, as Ken mentioned, already a translation done by Marshall Pill during the 1960s. And I was really unhappy with the translation, not because it was a bad translation, but the story seemed truncated, right? I mean, the story seemed like there was a, it had this feel like somebody wrote it and then took a whole bunch of parts out of it, and it was a abbreviated versions, because there were a lot of story threads that never is resolved and so on. Later on, I found out that, to my horror, there's actually 34 different versions of this story. And the longest one, which is the one I translated, is 5 times longer than the shortest one. And the Marshall Pill version is one of the shortest ones. And I found out why. It has to do with the way in which popular literature was spread during the Joseon Dynasty in Korea, that when a work became popular, publishers would start publishing increasingly shorter versions of it to save money on paper. Right, so over time, the story got shorter and shorter and shorter, and also that allows scholars to determine which is probably the earliest, if not the oral text, but one they're closest to it, which are the longest ones, and also the ones that are handwritten, because printers at that time did not solicit original works, but they looked for handwritten works that were already enjoying popularity, and then started printing those out, and if those succeeded, shorter and shorter and shorter, right? Now, during the 60s, when Marshall Pill took on this task, that version was thought to be the most authoritative, but we now know for a fact that that is actually an abbreviated version of a much much longer one. So I had to go through all these manuscripts and look at the scholarship and so on. But what had happened was that I was unhappy with the translation, so I thought to myself as an undergrad, you know what, this would be a nice task for me to take on. Right. Look at it and see if there's a different translation I could do. And I promised myself I'll do that and I'll revisit it and so on. Right. Years passed. and for various different personal reasons, I decided to go into European history rather than Asian history. And basically, it was after I got tenure that I got people off my back. Right, and so I can do whatever hell I want now, you know, and this was so many years after this, right? And so I was like, okay, got the tenure book done, and so on, right? So I'm gonna do something fun, you know. It came back to me, right? I made this promise to myself, so I went back, and I actually thought this was gonna be an easy task, right? Do a translation, which will be a challenge because, you know, I mean. Even for most Koreans, these pre-modern Korean is very, very difficult. The expressions are all different and so on and so on. And you have to deal with the amount of Chinese characters that are in there along with the Korean native Hangul script. But first of all, I found out to my horror that there's 34 different manuscripts. And I had to go through them and consult with scholars in Korea about which one I should do. And then I looked into later scholarship about the significance of the story, and I stepped on a scholar's landmine, right? Because there is what vast majority of Koreans think they know about this, not just about what's in the story, which most of them have never read, but there's also what they've been taught in school as to its significance, right? When it was written, who it was written by, and what are its ideological messages in it, and so on. I found that it's all wrong. for instance, the idea is that this was a work written by a writer named Hogyun in the 17th century, that he was one of the great poets of Joseon Dynasty. It was okay. And he was also like a Joseon Dynasty proto-socialist who wanted to create a revolution in Joseon to create a more fair society. And the story of Hong Gildong is like a narrative political manifesto of his radical ideas, right? And that's deeply set. And that also another complete and utter myth that some of you may think. that the, this is the important, because this is the first work of fiction written in the native Hangul script. No, it wasn't, right? But the problem is that that's source of a lot of Koreans' pride, right, about its importance, right? And the other thing that I, you know, and when I was starting talking with professors in Korea about this, the thing that they all complained about why all of this is pretty well known among scholars who looked into this, about its origin and so on, why it doesn't get out. I mean, this latest research doesn't get out, and it has become an idée fixe, right? And for reasons that Minjin pointed out, this is such an important story, right? Even for the vast majority of Koreans who never read this, this has such deep resonance. And part of that resonance is the fact that this great writer from the 17th century, way back in the 17th century, wrote this, and he wrote this in the native script that, you know, King Sejong the Great, you know, invented for the sake of the common people, and it has this radical message. It's almost like, you know, it's looking forward to the kind of democratic country that Korea became, right? And then the fight against authorities and so on, right? Unfortunately, all of that just kind of, you know, I mean, you know, as from my training as a historian, I started looking at all the evidence, just started falling apart. So I just completely against my expectation, I had to redo the entire research, and I did come out with a better timeline. It's pretty certain that it's a work from the mid 19th century, that recent. It wasn't written by a yangban or nobleman writer at all, an anonymous popular writer, probably of a commoner class. And I looked into the reasons why, you know, all of this ideas get as I said, became idée fixe in the Korean imagination. And one of the things that a lot of professors in Korea told me was that this has to do with the problem of how literature is taught in Korean schools, right? In Korean schools, as you know, it's all about memorization. It's all about knowing that the college entrance exam is going to determine the rest of your life. So you just have to write off the 3 years of your high school years and just study and memorize, right? So the way in which literature is taught is that students are not given entire works to read and then asked to tell them how you feel about it and what you think. They're given a couple of paragraphs, and then they're given 5 to 10 facts to memorize that'll show up in the multi-choice questions at the college's entrance exams, right? And what are those facts? It was written by Hogyun in the 17th century. It's anti-feudalistic. It's the first Korean work written in the Hangul script, and that's why it's important. And it protests the Joseon Dynasty policy toward illegitimate children, and so on, right? Now, when they read that, they just have to memorize that and memorize it and memorize it. Even if later a scholar comes along and said, there's just no evidence for any of that, right? It becomes hard for them to really get out of the head. Also because they, you know, Koreans have been told over and over again, that's why this is so important. That's why we as Koreans should be so proud of this. I've had professors who told me that, there's one Professor Lee Yun-suk at Yonsei University. He's a leading expert on Hong Gildong and other traditional Korean fiction written in Hangul script. He every once in a while teaches class for high school Korean literature teachers, and he forces them to read the entire text. And there's this is nothing like what I taught them. Right? This is nothing like because there's all this kind of, you know, other things going on, and then they're completely confused. I don't know how I'm going to teach this, right? Because I'm going to get into trouble if I teach them these 5 or 6 facts that they have to memorize for their college entrance exam, which are all wrong, right? There's a couple of things. A while ago, when I started thinking about this, I saw this hilarious travel documentary on television where this travel crew went to the city of La Mancha in Spain. And La Mancha, which is where Don Quixote takes place, it looks like that entire town's economy based on Don Quixote tourism. Right? I mean, you go there and there's Don Quixote stuff everywhere, right? There's the statue, there's the windmill, and there's, you know, it's like, and people come. I mean, you know, people come for that. And you know, and everywhere they go, people are like, oh yeah, Don Quixote is so wonderful, Cervantes wonderful and all that, right? And then at the end of the documentary, the filmmaker started asking them, so when was the last time you read Don Quixote? Couldn't find a single person in the town who actually read the novel. Right? I mean, not a single one. You know, it's a big novel, right? And also, the other problem is that they think they know the story. Why do I need to? Because I know, you know, charging against the windmill, you know, all that, right? I mean, it's just so famous. And I think most Koreans feel that way. They feel that they know it. But just as I was surprised when I came to this project and I started reading this text very, very, very carefully, I realized what I thought I knew about Hong Gildong was actually not from the text itself, right? But it's from the countless cartoons, animated films, and dramatic representations, which a lot of it, most of them, as I show you, the story, the first part where, you know, dealing with the father, you know, I can't even call my father and all that, that's pretty faithful. But in the vast majority of retellings, once he goes off on an adventure, it's completely original stories, right? It's like, you know, nothing to do with the original text and so on. And so I had to do it, but to go into why I, you know, it turned out as a historian, it's fairly obvious that it's a 19th century work. It's a commercial fiction rather than a high level Yangban fiction. I would have to get into too much detail, but I promise you, I signed a contract with the University of Hawaii to lay it all out in a full book format, which you're liable to, as I'll show you in the slideshow, liable to get a lot of people pissed off in Korea, including the descendants of the Hogyun's family, right, who made this huge deal out of, you know, that's, you know, their ancestors' great achievement. And I'm also going to show you that in this entire town, that it's like La Mancha, it's, you know, it's tourism, it's based on Hong Gildong. But just to give you a little take on it, just a little taste of it. There's a tragic story of a literary scholar named Kim Tae-jun, who during the 1930s, during the imperial era, colonial era, he wrote the very very first book on the history of Joseon Dynasty fiction, right? And he was a fervent nationalist who really, really dreamed of Korean independence, but he was also a communist. And as a result, he wrote this book about where he examined all of the major works of Korean Joseon Dynasty fiction, in order to just tell Koreans that, you know, the Japanese are wrong when they call us barbarians. We are a cultured people who produces wonderful works of literature, and he loved the story of Hong Gildong, but he read it as a communist, as a proto-communistic story about a revolutionary. And he was the one who, you know, really affirmed, based on very specious, evidence. Hogyun had a student named Ishik, who said that Hogyun wrote a story called The Story of Hong Gildong, but there's no evidence that has anything to. I mean, there's no evidence that he actually wrote it, and there's no evidence that even if he wrote it, that has anything to do with the work that is extant today, right? So it's a very, very complicated thing. But you read Kim Tae-jun's text, and it's filled with just longing for independence and longing for national dignity and all that. But that his works have been so influential. It's even now, even today, historians of Korean literature are struggling with so many of his ideological readings of these books, including The Story of Hong Gildong. And he led a very tragic life, and it's a very tragic point in Korean history. So I understand why he needed to say all of these things about this work, but that in itself is an interesting story. But as a historian, I had to look at the truth of it. And just one last thing before I go to slide presentation. I think that this whole scholarship controversy with The Story of Hong Gildong, it bears a very weird reverse mirror image resemblance to the so-called Shakespeare authorship question, which is a huge freaking waste of time. Right? I mean, it's just stupid. I mean, it's just the whole thing. I mean, right. But I think there's many reasons why they've been all, despite the fact that, you know, all the evidence is there, there's a there's been persistent groups of fringe scholars who just refuse to believe that Shakespeare wrote this, right? And I think part of that is kind of an intellectual elitism. I mean, Shakespeare was a commoner, right? And if you look at the ideas for alternatives, Francis Bacon, Edward de Vere, this highfalutin, you know, intellectuals, right? Just talking with friends of mine who are Shakespeare scholars, it's fairly clear that like Shakespeare was very much prophet-minded, and there's all this evidence now that the romantic image of Shakespeare is that he wrote by candlelight, and you're just inspiration all that. During the Renaissance, who write by candlelight? Your eyes would just die in like a couple of years, right? No. There's all this evidence now that then now the way those plays got completed. I mean, Shakespeare did write them, but they kind of resemble modern-day script meetings where he would write a draft and he would get together around the table with the director and a couple of actors and a couple of other, and they would read it and the actors, I can't say this, this is too, and Shakespeare would say, okay, well, I need to rewrite it, but I got this other thing, so why don't you rewrite? And so it was a much more like a group, and Shakespeare was also, it was obvious, he was thinking about, how to put butts on the seats of the theater. I think there was there's sort of the intellectual elitism that they just can't believe a commoner who's driven by profit motive could create such wonderful works of art. It is fairly clear to me from my research that this was an anonymous commoner who just didn't even think this was so important that he put his name on it. Sometime in the middle of the 19th century, he wrote it for profit and so on. I think it's still a great work of literature, just as Shakespeare's is, right? And we don't need to believe that it was, a Hogyun who's from one of the most illustrious Yangban family, this great confusion of great Confucian scholars who wrote this work. I think in a weird way, that's a kind of an intellectual elitism that one would have to deal with. So that's the background, and I cannot tell you how gratified I am that this is made it into Penguin Classic as the first work translated from Korean. That makes me more happy than anything else. I'm happy for myself also, but I'm happy that so many people in the West are gonna know that name now. And hopefully they'll also realize that, that this is sort of the universal figure of which he's part, right? So I'd like to quickly go through some of the things that I found in my research that I think you'll find interesting. As pointed out, Hong Gildong, his name is used everywhere as a kind of a, John Doe. And also this constant reiteration of his story. So I would like to quickly go through what it is, some of the aspects of it. Major finds that I made that is of complete interest to, in my book, in the first three chapters of my book, I do the analysis of, the controversy and all of that, but my final two chapters are just on how they were reinterpreted in the modern era, right? If you go to the first one. This is a silent movie version. I mean, this may be the very first visual representation of the Hong Gildong story, right? And as you see, this is from the newspaper Dong-a-Ilbo from April of 1935, announcing the upcoming movie. And this is Hong Gildong talking with his minister father, and everybody's very excited, right? I mean, this is a great classic is going to be made into a movie. The scholarship of colonial era Korean films is really, really interesting, but it's unfortunately that almost none of the works from that era survives. Even like a massive blockbuster like the movie Arirang, which pretty much every Korean saw and wept, the only thing that survives is even works that survive, they're very badly damaged. We only have a couple of scenes and so on. So when I found out that there was a movie, I really, really wanted to find out what they did with the movie because they couldn't have done the entire story. I was like, how am I going to find out what the movie was like? Because it's lost. Then a friend of mine in Korea had told me that where you might be able to find this is that in popular magazines during the colonial era, for the benefit of people who lived in small towns and rural areas who couldn't go to movie theaters, they would have basically novelizations. right? And not only that, summaries of stories with film stills from the movies, right? And he said, you know, I don't know if they did one, but you should go look into it. So I did some research into it, and I found it. the next one. This is from a journal called Gajeong Iju, Gajeong Jiu, which means the friend of the household. And it's basically a woman's journal giving them instruction, giving them like sort of stories about, you know, home improvement and agricultural improvement. And every once in a while, they have these sort of novelizations with pictures on it. This is a practice derived from Japan, because in Japanese popular magazines, they used to do this a lot. And also, I found out that, I don't know if this is the case with Korea. I don't think I've ever found one. But and also in Japan, though, that form became so popular that they started to do ones that look like it for completely fictional films. Right? And in fact, so they would have stills from films that of non-existent. And they actually got famous actors to pose as if they're in a movie. Right? And in Korea, this was such a popular form that it was called 영화 소설, which means movie fiction. Right? And it described the entire story. And it was amazing. I couldn't believe I found it. Right? But it's very different. It's completely different. It's short. And what's weird is that if you go to the next one. Okay, so here he's talking with this woman, he's saying, "어서 숨읍시오, 산적들이 당신을 당신을 잡아가려 하니." Go hide yourself, because these bandits are gonna come to take you away, right? So that's not in the story at all, right? So woman's rescue, and what he does is he, what's remarkable is his main magic power in this movie. He does a series of sex changes. He just turns into women. So she runs away. He changes himself into her, right? So that when he gets, if you go to the next one, I'm sorry, this is very unclear. It's her, and there's the evil nobleman who's torturing her father because he wants him to, let him take his daughter as a concubine. And she appears and begs for his life and said, "Okay, I'll be your concubine." The evil nobleman takes the woman to his bedroom and boom, it's Hong Gildong, and said, "Gotcha!" and beats the crap out of him, right? If you go to the next one, the previous one, sorry. Right there. Okay, but what's really pretty damn remarkable about this is that at the end of the story, Hong Gildong dies. Because he finds out that his mother has been arrested, and he realizes that the only way he can rescue her is die in her stead. So again, he does a sex change and becomes his mother, and lets his mother escape and allows himself to be executed. Right? And I have this idea that this has to do with what I call the limits of resistance in the colonial era. We should resist. We should fight against authority, but it's very difficult, and you know, sometimes ultimate price has to be paid at the end. So none of this optimistic going off to a foreign place and creating a new kingdom and so on and so on, right? It's a very tragic story at the end. There's another version of the Hong Gildong that was done. I haven't been able to find much about it. But you know, No, in terms of the visual image of Hong Gildong, nobody is more important than the comic book artist Shin Dong-woo. He was probably South Korea's most important cartoonist, especially during the 60s and 70s. If you go to the next one. Basically what he does, it's starting in 1965. He started doing cartoons of Hong Gildong, and the way he imagined Hong Gildong, which is also the image from the very first slide of the presentation, this sturdy young man wearing a blue vest with a small yellow hat, that is the image that most South Koreans have of this guy. I mean, this was invented by Shin Dong-woo because it was a huge hit. And also, not only because the comic books were a hit, and as I'll show you, it was made into a movie, boy, they used that image for all kinds of advertising. I mean, for batteries, for ramen noodles, right? I have a clear image in my mind of when I was a little boy of watching a TV ad where he's selling soap, right? And he's beating the crap out of germs, and he's saying that just as Hong Gildong beat on corrupt noblemen, this soap will beat the crap out of germs, right? Especially during the 70s, it was everywhere. I mean, this the way in which he's portrayed everywhere. His importance, Shin Dong-woo's importance in terms of creating the iconic image of what Hong Gildong is supposed to look like, it cannot be over-exaggerated. I mean, that's the image. Now, not only is Shin Dong-woo important, if you go to the next one. These are the sort of comic book. By the way, me and my great friend Heinz Insu Fanko, we translated about 20 to 30 pages of this. Of the comic book, and you can find it in the journal Azalea, where my translation first appeared, right? So you have the comic book version of this. Next one, please. So it's a full painting. See, and two completely new characters. His love interest, Gopdani, which means the pretty one, right? And his little funny sidekick, Dosop Bawi, which means Sturdy Rock. Right, so three of them. It's completely invented adventure that nothing to do with what's in the original work, right? Completely invented one. Now, what's also interesting is that Shin Dong-woo was the most important comic book artist in South Korea at the time. His older brother, Shin Dong-hun, is also extremely important because he was the pioneering artist who used animation for commercials on South Korean TV, very, very important. And in 1965, two of them collaborated. And next one, please. This is the poster for the full-on Hong Gildong movie. And this is a very important movie because this is the very first Korean movie full-length animation film, right? The very first one, right? He was a huge hit, massive hit, and it further solidified and again, completely original story with the dragons and bats, and it's a lot of fun. I saw it in Korea at the Film Institute there, and it's a lot of fun. But again, just completely new kind of original story, right? Many new. There's a couple of other different movie versions and so on. But one that I love is the 1986 version. Next one, please. The North Korean Hong Gildong. Right. I'll try to make this short because I love telling the story, but because some of you may appreciate this, and some of you may know this. The just completely crazy ass surrealist dystopia that North Korea has become. I mean, the craziest story is how Kim Jong-il, before he became the leader, he was really into movies and he really wanted to create a film industry in North Korea. But he just got fed up because they sucked so badly, because there was no know-how and so on. So his idea of a solution to that he arranged the kidnapping of South Korea's leading director and actress. He kidnapped them, right? And he invited them to he had his agents invite him to a film festival in Hong Kong that was not existing. And as soon as they got there, North Korean agents grabbed them and put them on ships, and they got to North Korea and said, "You will make films for us now," right? Chaeun Hee, who's the actress who was kidnapped, she tells this amazing story about, being knocked out and then waking up, and she's in a hotel room and she opens the curtains and it's like downtown Pyongyang, right? And the door opens and Kim Jong-il comes in, and the thing that comes out of his mouth has become the most famous thing that he's ever said. He says, "I look like a dwarf piece of shit, don't I?" Right? And in the next years, the two of them made like 30 films for North Korea until they managed to convince Kim Jong-il that they were actually happy being there, so they were allowed to go to Europe to do advertising. And they made a beeline for the American embassy. Their two-volume memoirs of their experiences, still to this day, the most detailed information that we have about what life was like during the upper echelons of that society. It's completely bizarre stuff, right? Hong Gildong, we don't know, because this was released a year after they managed to flee. Different people got, they're not credited to it, but we know that Shin Sang-ok, who's the South Korean director, we don't know if he directed it and then another North Korean director took it or he supervised it. But we know that it came from the company that he was patronizing and he was teaching these latest techniques of filmmaking. It's pretty good stuff. So this is, he comes here and he plays the flute and said, "Piri bunun sanai Hong Gildong." It's this great North Korean accent, right? How is this one different? Well, interestingly enough, all North Korean movies are supposed to be, filled with propaganda, North Korean propaganda, but this one was pretty light on that. There is sort of anti-feudalistic message and so on. So if you, next, so he's fighting against, sort of regular stuff, fighting against the men of corrupt noblemen. In the last part of the film, that's when the really North Korean stuff comes out. Right, you go next time. Japanese ninjas. I swear, Japanese ninjas, okay? Out of nowhere, these Japanese ninjas show up, right? And they are stealing treasures from the royal palace, and they're kidnapping Korean women, right? And they're arranging for a ship to pick them up and take all these women over there. And Hong Gildong gets wind of it, and him and his half-brother, who's official in the Korean government, they team up and they fight the ninjas. Right? So if you know anything about North Korean propaganda, right? Anti-Japanese, right? I mean, that's just so filled with this, right? So anti-feudalism bit, that's actually pretty light. But the anti-Japanese part of it, right? It was just really, really intense. And that's the most, North Korean aspect of this, right? By the way, this entire film, available on YouTube. Right? Go to YouTube and search Hong Gildong, North Korea, and this entire movie comes out. And it's awesome. It's just completely awesome. What's interesting is that I recently there's a cable channel called Arirang in South Korea. That's an English language channel. They did a short take on Hong Gildong and so on. And part of it was that they showed scenes from the North Korean version. And they were just making fun of it, right? Oh, look, look how, ideological it is and how all this bizarre, and they're pointing out the ninja stuff and they said, oh God, they just invent. But the problem is that the South Koreans once do that too, right? They are all complete. I mean, one could say that, it's the South Korean versions where they go off in a completely, different stories. They're just as, filled with the ideology of capitalism. The ideology of Hallyu and so on and so on. So it was really kind of disturbing for me for them to do the story where they're making fun of the North Koreans, but not really taking that kind of critical approach to the South Korean versions, right? Also at the end, what's to me interesting is that, I have this whole theory about why as socialistic and, propagandistic North Korean films can be, anti-authoritarianism, they have to be very careful with, right? Because that's a double-edged sword, right? You praise Hong Gildong and his outlaw activities for standing up to, the oppressive regime, people might get ideas, right? What's the oppressive regime right now? It's completely surprised at the end. When Hong Gildong is not given permission to marry a girl from a noble family, instead of saying, hey, what's up? I mean, I just killed all these ninjas and so on. I'm too grateful, right? Can I get the next one? They just leave. They all get on a ship and leave, him and his mom and his love interests and so on, right? I mean, he never even registers a protest to the king, right? And the movie ends with them saying, the search for a life of equality and justice, could they ever find it in this life, right? Very light. I mean, the North Korean propaganda, it's supposed to be anti-feudalistic, anti-monarchistic, but he's just saying, okay, well, I'm going to get out of here, and so on. Okay, so as a kind of example of the sort of South Korean version of their own version of the weirdness, in the early 21st century, the network SBS did a Hong Gildong series and it completely failed. Nobody was really interested because it tried to do something more traditional. So when they tried to do it again, a different network, they need to jazz it up. right? They couldn't just do a tradition. They need to show something new, right? And also, we entered into the age of Hallyu, right? The great spread of Korean popular culture. So if for this to be a success, it couldn't be just be a domestic success. It could be, it had to have a resonance among the Chinese and and other places and so on, right? So, Kwedo Hong Gildong, Sharp Blade Hong Gildong, the new network presentation. Next one. The dude wearing a sunglasses. The dude is wearing sunglasses, you know? So 2008, and done by Network KBS. If you take in the spirit of fun, it is a lot of fun, right? Because there's hip hop music, right? And the story is just completely odd and all that. But there's also kind of a weird, it's just completely new adventure. It doesn't have anything to do with the original script, but also it's trying to get that kind of a Hallyu audience, right? Younger, hipper, and for people who are familiar with Korean pop, K-pop music, and so on. The next one. So Kang Ji-won plays Hong Gildong, and look at the hairstyle. Do they look like Joseon Dynasty people to you? And if you're an enthusiast of K-pop, you'll recognize Song Yuri, who plays his love interest, as a former member of Finkel, the big band, girl group that was there. It's all very young, and it's like they use Chinese expressions every once in a while. And then at one point she said that when I was in Ching China, I saw these Westerners, I don't know what they were saying, but every time they hug each other and kiss each other, they said "I love you," right? And when she starts falling in love, and she keeps saying "I love you" in English, right? Because she's too embarrassed to say it in Korean, right? So it's like, the one thing, I mean, it's pretty bizarre, but I have to say one thing. The ending completely took me by surprise because it was way more radical than the North Korean version. It ends with him actually fighting to the death against the king, right? And actually being a proto-democrat. He said, justice will always, injustice will always prevail until we have a new system of government where people will choose their leaders, right? And it ends with this just grand epic scene. And then, the scene of, old-time capital switches to modern-day Seoul, and the narrator says the spirit of Hong Gildong is still alive today fighting against injustice, right? And a much more radical message, which is kind of interesting. One more thing, next one. So this is a movie called Descendants of Hong Gildong, about modern-day descendants, their family of thieves. This is available on Netflix as the movie Righteous Thief. It's pretty damn funny, right? I mean, they're just like, they're descendants, and they go after corporate criminals in modern-day Korea, right? And they're con men, right? But they don't keep the money. They give it to charity and so on, right? It's a lot of fun movie. Last series that I want to point out is that, starting in the late 1990s with small towns and communities being given autonomous sort of rule over their local affairs, they also had to find themes to attract internal tourism, right? And upon a completely, ridiculous basis, there's a place called Changsun County that's near the city, southern city of Gwangju. It's quite near it. And there used to be an illustrious Hong family who lived there. And based on a completely specious evidence, the town said, Hong Gildong, this is where he comes from. Right? This is where he comes from. And so they built this entire tourist industry based on this is the hometown of Hong Gildong, right? And they built this massive, massive Hong Gildong park. It's attracting little kids because they can stay there overnight, a lot of activities, they can do arrow shooting and all of that, right? So if you go to the next one. This is at the statue at the front of the Changsun County Railway Station. And it's like, welcome to the hometown of Hong Gildong, right? And next one. New heroes, his buddies. I find it really interesting. So they make up new heroes about this and come in. And the place is huge. I mean, this is like it's called the Hong Gildong theme park, right? And the next one. And it's beautiful, and it goes on and on. But one of the, to me, especially as a historian, the one I found interesting is that scholars of historically important sites have pointed out that there's a tendency in our time to the line between amusement parks and sites of historical importance to become blurred, right? And it's disturbing because, the profit motive of having an amusement park can seriously damage what they are going for, which is historical authenticity, right? And they built it on this site because there was the old home of the illustrious Hong family around which they built this myth that the real-life Hong Gildong. Oh, by the way, there was a real-life Hong Gildong who was a bandit, who was arrested in the year 1500, but we don't know anything about him. We just know that he caused a lot of damage so that he shows up in the royal records. And what they did to bring a sort of level of authenticity, if you get the next one, they rebuilt the Hong's family home with a mannequin of supposedly Hong Gildong's father and Hong Gildong kneeling before him, right? You read a placard at that site, and what it says is that this is Hong Gildong, and he's about to go off on his adventures, and here's his father telling him to go forth and fight for justice and for the common people, which is a complete distortion of the story. In the story, he's defying his father, right? And he's going against his order because his father tells him not to go, but he says, I gotta go, I gotta be. Now, so the thing is that this is a park mainly for children, and I think they, you see what I mean, right? I mean, they couldn't have the story about this, hero defying his father and saying, screw you, I'm gonna be. So they twisted the story, so he's obeying his father now to go forth and become a great hero and champion of the people and so on, right? So this is huge. I mean, this is really interesting. So as you see that, I know that like this year there's a movie called Detective Hong Gildong that came out. Unfortunately, I missed it. I would have liked to have seen it interpreted. But as a side, this is going on. You still have the park, and so this is very much part of Korean culture. Right, thank you so much. I appreciate it.
Professor Minsoo, that was such a great and like hilarious and also often very profound talk. And in fact, you answered pretty much all the questions I had.
Oh, okay.
But what I thought I could do is sort of buy the audience some time and ask a few questions, and then you guys can percolate. So the line that Minjin read also struck me in the introduction, where you talk about Hong Gildong as a sort of like symbol of Korean national identity, like a kind of nationalist hero. But what struck me with your presentation is that it's not as though there's one Hong Gildong who represents one essential Korea. It's more like there's several different aspects of Hong Gildong that get pulled out and reconstructed each time there's a different Korea. So there's like the anti-feudalist, socialist Hong Gildong. There's the Hong Gildong who's the humiliated outsider, in the context of like colonial humiliation. I was wondering if you could talk about that and the way that Hong Gildong mutates. And also I found what you said really interesting about the idea that just as there are these different incarnations of Hong Gildong, there's also this sort of 20th, 21st century Hong Gildong of South Korean pop culture where who's also expressing like new values that are not to do with anti-feudalism or anti-Japanese sentiment or things that seem more like historicized, but about South Korean capitalism.
Yeah, absolutely. And as I pointed out, if you look at Robin Hood scholarship, there are many, many different Robin Hoods. That one story that everybody thinks that know. The story that everybody thinks that they know about Robin Hood is actually from the Errol Flynn movie. That story is for most people what they think they know about Robin Hood. But the story is different. As I mentioned in my book, I think there's two separate questions. Understanding the classic novel in itself, right? And getting an accurate understanding of when it was produced and what it represented and so on. And there's a whole separate other question about what Hong Gildong became, you know, in the modern era, rewritten and reimagined and so on and so on. One of the things I love about, loved about writing the second part was that Hong Gildong represented so many things. Like, for instance, in South Korea alone, you have Hong Gildong as the enduring symbol of fight against unjust authority, right? But also it becomes symbol of the perfect Korean masculine hero that modern day, everyday Koreans cannot possibly hope to measure up to. The things that I showed you are mostly from fun popular culture, but I've also found dozens of literary novels written at a very high and complicated novels, at a complicated literary level. The vast majority of them talks about masculine failure. And there's so many lament about, like, I can't be like Hong Gildong. I'm a harassed salaryman who can barely make payments. And how am I supposed to, measure up to his reputation? And there's stories like this. The only translated work is by So Hye-jin. And the only one written by a woman. And it's about a man with severe suicidal depression who's constantly dreaming about Hong Gildong and said, I can never measure up to being Hong Gildong. And if only I had Hong Gildong's power where I can make a bunch of different versions of myself, right? I can just commit suicide and they could just carry on my life so that my wife wouldn't become a widow and my children wouldn't be childless and so on. So there's that constant lament that I find interesting. So it becomes a story of both empowerment and sort of the lack of virility on the part of modern men. So the male crisis is often depicted in terms of, how we can't be a Hong Gildong. And also the other really interesting thing that I point out. So one of the cliches about the Korean character is we're a people full of Han. Everybody knows the concept of Han, right? This deep sorrow, right? That's what characteristics of it, right? This deep bone, and it's not just sadness, it's not just depression, it's a sense of having been deprived of our destiny. So I'm thinking, if I only got into Seoul University, my life would have been so, I'm full of Han, right? If only that woman that I loved, that I was madly in love with had loved me back, my life would have been completely different and I'm full of Han, right? And so on. So that's one of the cliches about, Korea. And people, point out that, all the tragedies that we went through and so on. And in a lot of those Han depictions, Hong Gildong shows up, right? His Han, because of the illegitimate, status and so on, right? Here's the thing. I recently discovered a thesis that I find very convincing, that the notion of Korean character as being full of Han is basically a Japanese invention that was created during the colonial era. The imperial mission was to, ostensible mission was to take care of the savage people, and you people are so sad. With your sad culture and your sad history. I mean, you're full of Han. And, it's okay. We'll come and modernize you. I mean, that's what the great enterprise of the empire was about, right? Now, scholars have pointed out that the concept of Han certainly did exist in the Joseon Dynasty, but you can't find a single writer who thought that there was a defining characteristics of the Korean nature. Right, and in fact, oftentimes in traditional writings, the concept of Han is opposed to the concept of Hung, which means joy. Right, so yes, we are full of Han, but we're also full of Hung as well, and it nicely balances out, and it's that balance that really determines the Korean character. But it was really in the Japanese out there, you had a series of Japanese cultural critics who would look upon Korean character and say, oh, it's so sad, it's so full of Han, and so on. Yet we adopted it unthinkingly. Thinking that this is a traditional concept when it's very recent and it's not, it's really not even of, native tradition. And I think the story of Hong Gildong, you pointed out how funny it was and how enjoyable it was. don't you see that there's that kind of nice balance between, you know, the Han, you know, the depression and the sadness, but at the same time this joyous outbreak. And as a result, again, I mean, that's a problem with the modern readings of it, of thinking that we are looking at it in a certain perspective, but that's a very modern lens when a lot of people think it's traditional. Right.
That's really mind-blowing about Han.
Yeah.
So one thing you brought up about Hong Gildong as this model of virility is this question of gender. And it's interesting because he's sort of infinitely virile, but he's also kind of cut off from the father, right? Yeah. The source of virility. And his origin is actually mixed up with gender, where the minister wants to impregnate his wife. She spurns his advances. He basically rapes, likely.
Oh, that's total rape. I mean, that's a slavery situation. And she doesn't have a choice.
Yeah. I was wondering if you could talk about the gender dimensions, particularly the adaptation you just talked about, where his superpower is gender bending. And what do you think that's about? Especially if Hong Gildong is about pure masculinity.
Yeah, absolutely. So when you read the story of Hong Gildong purely as Joseon Dynasty literature, coming out of Joseon Dynasty, there's no getting around the fact that this is a work that comes out of a profoundly patriarchal culture. I mean, there's no doubt about this, right? Especially in the way the women are portrayed, right? So you got the sort of, you know, the Madonna whore there. So you have the, you know, the good woman is always the one who's patient, who's not complaining, who's faithful to the man in her life and so on. And any woman that shows any kind of ambition, any kind of desire for power and control is an evil bitch, right? I mean, that's sort of a constant theme in a patriarchal culture. And once Hong Gildong empowers himself, these three beautiful women just fall on his lap, right? And it's completely, unproblematic. It's interesting that, you know, in his early life, he complains about his treatment as an illegitimate son. But what we find is once he becomes a king, you still have the same practice, right? I mean, three women come along, marries one, and turns the other two into concubines. Right. One of the major interpretation of the story of Hong Gildong, it's a protest literature against the treatment of illegitimate son. But it's weird how like Hong Gildong as a king completely forgets about this. Right. And just and doesn't, you know, mention any kind of a new reform, period. Now, what's really interesting is that in 20th century versions of it, the gender stuff gets really, really, really interesting because in almost every new version, there's a woman involved. There's a love interest. And as in, I've got the name of the scholar, but there's a book called Remasculization of Korean Cinema, where what it is that women, the sufferings of women are used to measure one's masculine strength because one's sense as a man is judged by how well you can protect the women in your life, or failing that, if the woman gets raped or killed, avenge them, right? And it's masculine because the suffering is always represented primarily as a assault upon the man's dignity, not on the woman, not what the woman goes through, right? And you see that in modern Hong Gildong story over and over and over again. They insert a female character, a helpless female character who gets violated or who gets threatened to gets violated. And Hong Gildong is seen as somebody who jumps in because he has to prove his masculinity. Which in a patriarchal society, it's not problematic, right? But I think the idea is that during the colonial era, Korean men felt feminized as the subservient to the Japanese colonial authority, right? After liberation, dictatorial governments, a masculine problem becomes a very, very, very difficult issue. And as a result, this gender problem becomes much more interesting. And it's interesting, but also, again, it's very male. It's not, I mean, the interest is really not on what the women go through. It's about, you know, what the men go through when the women in their lives get violated and, you know, and assaulted and so on, right? I think there ought to be a kind of an interesting revision to this in recent stuff.
It seems like someone in the audience should write the next Hong Gildong adaptation where Hong Gildong is a woman, right?
Yeah, oh, absolutely. I'm really hoping that, you know, this will spur more revisionist takes on it. You know, Hong Gildong comes to America, you know, descendants of Hong Gildong, and, you know, and so on, right?
Played by Eddie Murphy.
Yeah, yeah. Hong Gildong meets Robin Hood, you know. No, Scarlett Johansson.
Are there questions, or do you want me to ask one more question to buy you some time? So I thought a lot of your readings, you're bringing out these political dimensions of Hong Gildong, but at the same time, in the introduction, you're very, and in your presentation, you're very cautious to not read it simply as protest literature, mm-hmm. and point out in the same way that Minjin did that, Hong Gildong is fighting the system, or he's fighting the corrupt people, but he's not fighting the system.
Right.
And when you talk about Hobsbawm talking about the noble bandit, the noble robber, what do you think it is about this character, that this archetype, where they're liberal, but they're not a revolutionary?
I'm glad you brought that up. So basically, it's I think if you get any complicated work of literature, trying to fit it into one of the binary categories of subversive or conservative is always a simplifying task, right? Because any work of literature will dilute that kind of simplistic characterization, right? Tolstoy's Anna Karenina a conservative work? Because it talks about the horrible consequences of adultery and the woman's punished and all that? Or is it subversive because she's such a sympathetic character? It's a stupid question, right? I mean, there are conservative elements in it, and there are subversive elements in it, and and so on. The thing is, I've gotten some interviewers and scholars asking me, characterizing my interpretation as a conservative one, as opposed to the traditional one, which is a subversive one. That wasn't my point at all. I think there's so many elements of it that is incredibly subversive. The way Hong Gildong messes with the king, right? And also the biggest crime, one of the biggest crimes that he commits is there was a very, very strict law in Joseon Dynasty against commoners dressing up as officials. By the way, I found some evidence that the real life bandit named Hong Gildong did that. Right? I found the royal record where they said that he would dress up as an official to go in and out of official buildings, right? That's all very subversive. The fact that this illegitimate son becomes a king, all that. But it's not. I mean, just because it's subversive, it's not anti-feudalistic. Because basically, when he gets to create his own country, he replicates Joseon Dynasty political system there. He just completely replicates it with him as a absolute leader. There's no democracy doing anything like that. So it's subversive, but at the same time, it's not anti-feudalistic. It's not, proto-socialistic. It's none of those things. But the problem is that because that scholar I mentioned during the 1930s, Kim Tae-jun, he was a communist, and he really did a communist reading of this thing and of the story. And because his interpretation is so, so influential, that's what most Koreans still, how they interpret it. It's anti-feudalistic and anti-monarchistic, and that the writer Hogyun was sort of a Joseon Dynasty proto-socialist. Right? I'm not making a conservative argument. I'm just saying that, you know, taking any work of art and, you know, trying to fit it into one or two categories, it's a futile exercise.
Questions right here.
So I would like to return to this concept of liminality that was brought up in the final introductory remark with regard to Hong Gildong's status,
yeah.
Namely his being neither completely a complete nobility or a commoner. Now, I was thinking about this with regard to the novels or the works appeal both in late Joseon society mm-hmm. and also contemporarily. Now, I mean, I have no idea about the structures of the institution of popular literature in Joseon. I mean, like, immediately it makes me think, if there are commoners that are consuming this, why would they necessarily want their hero, right, you know, to be still, like, at least half, you know, half part of nobility?
Uh-huh.
And also, just as nowadays in American society, people are reluctant to see themselves as no longer being middle class, right? It's still harboring this fantasy of belonging to the middle class. I mean, is this something similar in Korea. I mean, they look to Hong Gildong and they identify with him. And so they, in a sense, refuse to see themselves, right, maybe as full commoners.
Right. No, I that's a great question, and I love Min Jin's idea of the liminality playing such an important role, right? Because you know, I mean, he does fall in the middle, you know, not a commoner, not a nobleman, and so on, and it's so I think one of the ways in which to think about it. So he's born into a situation where he is finding himself constantly falling to the gap between two norms, right? One could interpret the whole story about how to regain his place in a way that he's not this sort of liminal creature, right? So in the beginning, he's part of two communities. One is the larger extended family of the Hong family, and also part of the Yangban class, the noble class of Korea. But he's also alienated from that, right? Because he can't take the examinations, you know, like the noble and all that. So how do I gain my place? So eventually it becomes rebellion and then, you know, becoming a king in his own right and so on, right? As to the question that you're asking about Joseon Dynasty, I'm pretty confident that this is a work that came out in the middle of the 19th century, and in the middle of the 19th century, Joseon Dynasty was falling apart, right? I mean, these statuses, this four-tiered class system was falling to pieces, and the monarchy was being completely ineffectual, and there's a series of massive, rebellions against the state that were occurring, and, you know, attempts at reforms that go nowhere, and so on. So it's this confusion, right? It's this confusion, and liminality, I think it's plays into that, because I think that, you know, in the second half of the 19th century, Joseon Dynasty Koreans felt that they were living in a liminal state, where the old days are gone, but the shape of the new society that's coming is not been set yet. I think that's part of like a really interesting part of the questions that you were asking about, you know, why is he, you know, an illegitimate son of a nobleman rather than, you know, voice of the people? Because there are two other really famous real-life bandits, from the Joseon Dynasty, In-Gok-jung and Jang-gil-sang, right? They are both from the lower class, so why not them, right? Why not them? They've also been the subjects of novels and, you know, films and so on, right? But it's Hong Gildong that's really famous. The story of Hong Gildong has the distinction of being the only work of traditional Korean literature where a illegitimate son is the hero. And the other beloved Korean story, the story of Chunhyang, right, is the only story where it's an illegitimate daughter of a nobleman. Right? I think that speaks to the time period. In my book, I have to be really careful about this, but the last great rebellion that occurred in Joseon Dynasty in the 1890s was the Donghak Rebellion, which is sort of this new religion that was created. I see sort of thematic similarities because they were, you know, they raised a rebellion and they, you know, and later on, modern interpreters are going to think of them as sort of these proto-modernists who want to create a new society, but you look at their manifestos, and they're actually very traditional. They want a good king, right? They don't want democracy. That's too far beyond their imagination. And they're constantly saying, you know, our king, King Hojong, is beset by corrupt officials who are giving him bad advice. So we want to raise this rebellion and show him, you know, the voice of the people and so on. So in the similar way, you have, you know, conservatism and subversion and all that, right? So I think to answer your question, I think that, you know, liminality had a lot of resonance at that time because, you know, as I said, you know, Korea was in a very liminal period in the second half of the 19th century.
Yes.
How do you get connected to a Penguin classic? I mean, that's a feat on its own.
I was completely surprised. An earlier version of this was published in the journal Azalea, which comes out of the Korea Institute at Harvard. That whole thing was interpreted. My wonderful editor at Penguin was actually looking for more Asian stuff. And he happened to read this, and he said he couldn't stop reading it, and it was really wonderful, and they did just such a sensational job, both Sam and Andrea, who did the publicity for it. I'm really, really grateful for them. And so it just happened by chance. And also it opened up another one, because now the language, the Literature Translation Institute in Korea are actively funding new translations of works. And they just threw some money at me. So I'm like, okay, I'll do another one.
What are you going to do?
So the gender issue, I'm going to do one that directly addresses that. I'm going to do an English translation of the story of Queen In-hyun, which tells the story of a 17th century queen. And it's full on the Joseon Dynasty version of the Madonna whore complex. Because it has the queen who's the the paragon of virtue, and the evil concubine Jang Hee-bin, who's just the evil whore, who steals the affection of the king away from him. And it's in many ways for modern readers it's very disturbing, because again, what is a good woman? Quiet, obedient, long suffering without complaint. What is an evil woman? The first one was a good one. Evil woman, ambitious, power hungry. And I really believe that that story is as famous as Hong Gildong's story. It did a lot of damage to the advancement of women's rights in Korea. That it really represents the old style confusion mode of thought about what a good woman, bad woman. But also, I think, also in a kind of inadvertently subversive way, that entire classic novel is all about. Technical title of the story is "The Record of the Virtue of Lady Min Queen In-hyun." Right? It's all about her, and the evil concubine is a minor character. But in virtually every modern rendition of the story, nobody gives a shit about the queen. Everybody's interested in the evil woman. I mean, she's so much more interesting. It's fascinating. To bring my perspective as a European historian, that story bears an interesting resemblance to the story of King Henry VIII's first divorce from Catherine of Aragon, right? Nobody cares about Catherine of Aragon. I mean, everybody's interested in Anne Boleyn. Even the stories where they portray him as not a very good character, as a villain, but she's so much more fascinating. And I think what that story did is it inadvertently gave a gift to Korean culture of a model of a woman, who's not all passive and who's not all obedient, to the extent that I noticed that in very recent, by very recent I mean starting from the 1990s onwards, the very recent reinterpretation of the story of Queen In-hyun, they really, put a positive spin on the concubine, on Jang Hee-bin, and I think that was done I think it was KBS also, they did a drama of no less than 100 episodes of this story, 100 episodes, right? And Jang Hee-bin was played by Kim Hae-soo, who's one of the most famous actresses. And I found this wonderful interview with her about her thinking, well, I have to reimagine her, right? I mean, I can't just portray her as this evil woman. I have to really try to understand internally what her motivation was like for committing all these acts. So literally, that's interesting. But also, as a historian, that's interesting because if you really look at the history part of it, who these women were like were completely inconsequential. They were just pawns in a political game that King Sukjeong was playing with the different factions within the government. I mean, they it's the novel that they made a much more bigger deal about who they were. And so it's like layers and layers of complexity, which I just love. I mean, it's just
more questions. Yes.
So do you worry with all this movie, just taking the name Hong Gildong and then making a new movie out of it, which has no relationship with the actual text? And then with this the theme park, where they are making these whole different stories about Hong Gildong and their relationship with his father, and kids are taking this as the stories, and in school where they learn all these five facts, and scholars know about this, but you know, not doing anything about it. I mean, yeah. They are probably, but not much. And, you know, and if they are taking these movies and all this stuff too far, and how far can they take, and, you know, just to make money out of it, should we worry? Or do you worry?
Let's say I am highly ambivalent about it. Because the fact that it's being reinterpreted this way and that and all that is a sign of its power, right? And I want the creative people to do reinterpretation and so on. I'm fine with that. But the part that which I really have severe problem with that there's that, and then there's the work itself, right? And people should look at it. In Korea, I did an interview with a journalist, and what I actually said that I think we should have a national campaign so that every Korean feels duty-bound to read it, right? Just so they know what it's about, right? What it actually says, right? And if there's if people have a clear distinction between, you know, what the original work is and, you know, what is signified and sort of new version, and I'll be fine with that. And I think... I think it's very healthy for people to do new interpretations and so on. And I like it when they do. I mean, I love reimagined versions of Shakespeare stories and so on. To make it more relevant. When people stop doing that, that's a sign that the story is no longer relevant. So I don't want it to be, irrelevant. So that's why I think it's healthy they make new movie versions of it, updated versions of it, you know, modern day versions of it. And I hope, and as I said, I hope Hong Gildong comes to America and other places as well. You're also right. I don't want that to be part of a confusion about what the original work was. The problem is that I don't think the solution will be solved until the Korean school system start teaching literature in a different way, right? And I don't see that happening because the educational reform is such a difficult thing in Korea. I'm ambivalent about it, but I think, by my, writing about this in the intro and, writing a book about it and so on, hopefully they'll have some impact on it, right?
Well, I think we all found this incredibly enlightening and also very funny. We have books for sale in the back from Marie Minjin and, of course, the Penguin Classics, Hong Gildong, as well as some wine. Please stick around, buy a copy, and get Minsoo to sign. And let's give him a hand.
Reading books by South Asian authors.
They were kind of a buffer because they could go places and be